Hi viewers, you're welcome to this segment of our Christmas special program, This Christmas. And I've got right here a very special person in the person of Ms. Eklund DeRosso. She is communications manager for the American Red Cross right here in the city of Houston. And we are right here in their building, beautiful building, if I may say. Ms. DeRosso, welcome to our program. How are you?
I'm well, thank you for having me. Really appreciate you coming down to our chapter to talk to us about the Red Cross.
Yes, I'm very excited to be doing this. So basically, we're here to poke your brain a little bit. We want to let our community know more about the American Red Cross, your services, your operations, and what we as a community can do to be involved with your operations, with your programs. So first of all, I would like for you to tell the viewers, what is the American Red Cross? What do you do, and especially here in the city of Houston?
Okay, well, the Red Cross has a mission.
Okay.
And our mission is to alleviate suffering in the face of a disaster. So we do this by mobilizing the power of our volunteers and the generosity of our donors.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, so some of the things, some of the programs that we have that are ongoing mm-hmm. are preparedness programs. So we go out in the community and we give talks about how to prepare for disasters. And it can be any kind of a disaster. So, you know, here in Houston, mm-hmm. we have a lot of flooding.
Yes.
So we have information on how to prepare for flooding.
Okay.
We have information, one of our biggest campaigns, we have a goal.
Okay.
By 2025 to reduce home fires.
Wow.
So that is a major program with us. And
wow.
It runs every single day. We have special events that we run. We're having
okay.
one on January 13th. In honor of Martin Luther King Day.
Wow.
We're gonna have a bunch of volunteers get together and go into the historic Third Ward area and install smoke alarms free of charge
wow.
to the residents there. We're hoping to get to about 800 homes.
Wow.
That's our goal.
That's beautiful.
Yeah.
So how can we include the African community in programs like this? Is it something that we as a community need to do? Do we need to approach the Red Cross, or is there a way that the Red Cross can include addresses, businesses, organizations from our community in your programs?
So the best way mm-hmm. to help the Red Cross, just like I said, through the power of our volunteers.
Okay.
So volunteer for the Red Cross. You can
wow.
sign up online.
Mm-hmm.
You can come into a chapter like this one
mm-hmm.
and walk into our volunteer services office, and someone will help you
mm-hmm.
Sign up to become a volunteer. They'll show you like all the different programs that we have. So maybe you're not interested in sheltering,
mm-hmm.
but you really have an affinity for veterans affairs.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe you're a former military person, or you're a military part of a military family.
Family. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so then you could volunteer for our service in the Armed Forces group.
Wow, and that would help bring information, enlightenment to our community, because we have volunteers coming from our community for the program. That it's so easy.
It is. You know, and another arm of our servicing armed forces is the international arm.
Okay.
So we deal a lot with family reunifications.
Wow.
Yes, it's one of those programs where, you know, it gets you so emotional.
Really? Can you tell us a story from there?
Well, I can tell you one of our fund development officers,
okay.
she actually has a story
wow.
where her family was contacted
right.
by the Red Cross before she was even with the Red Cross.
Wow.
So one day her phone rings. It's during the holidays, actually.
Wow.
Her phone rang. She picked it up, and it was this gentleman from the Red Cross.
Mm-hmm.
And he was telling her that he asked her if he knew this person. She said, "No, I don't know who this is."
Wow.
He's like, "Well, you know, this person tells us, they gave like all this information," and it turned out he was her half brother.
Oh, wow.
So her father spent some time in Czechoslovakia before the walls came down.
Uh-huh.
And he had like a whole other family there.
Oh.
But it turned out that this gentleman was her half-brother.
Wow.
And they called to reunify them because he knew about her, but she didn't know about him. Yeah, so she found a whole other family.
That's so beautiful.
Thanks to the Red Cross Reunification Program.
That is absolutely heartwarming.
Yeah.
And it happened during the Christmas time?
It happened during Christmas time.
Yay, but we also Christmas do rocks.
We also the dust rock. We also do reunifications for groups or for people or during times of disaster. So say that you have family who they're in an area or a part of the world that is experiencing some turmoil,
okay,
and you've lost touch.
Right.
You know, we will work to try and find them with our network because we are an international organization. To try and find your family member.
Wow, that is absolutely great, especially for families who have family back home in Africa. And there's a lot of countries in Africa that are going through crisis, wars, all kinds of things. And people worry about if their families back home are safe. So this is a really good program for you, you know, to know about. So I'm really glad we're having this talk. So, also, I think our community would like to know, how can they support the American Red Cross programs, you know, aside from volunteering, which you've already talked about.
Yeah.
What else can we do?
Well, like I said, volunteering is the primary, but also the generosity of our donors,
okay,
right? So supporting the Red Cross through donations is critical.
Okay.
You know, people who donate to the Red Cross when there isn't a disaster,
okay,
those funds allow us to immediately respond when a disaster happens.
Makes sense.
It's so critical. It's so critical. Because it's great, you know, once a disaster happens, people, you know, their hearts are open and they want to make sure that the people who've been affected by whatever disaster is happening, you know, get those services that we provide. But those people who donate before that disaster happens, those are the ones who really make it possible for us to get there, like, at a moment's notice.
Wow, that's awesome.
Yeah.
So there you go, viewers. Make sure you plug in. Go to the American Red Cross website. We will have the information scrolling at the bottom of your screen. You know, sign up to be a volunteer. Sign up to be a sponsor. And get involved in the programs that the American Red Cross offers right here in your city, City of Houston. So now, Hurricane Harvey happened, and it affected everyone.
Oh, yeah.
It was such a wide scale of destruction going on. So, and I know that the American Red Cross was one of the very first responders to this situation. So how did that unfold for you, for the Red Cross, and what are the programs that you have in place post-Harvey right now?
So the response was one of the more major efforts
Thank
that
you.
We undertook.
Right.
The hurricane first hit in Corpus Christi,
right,
and then it went all the way up and hit the entire thing all the way up to Orange, you know, Texas and in East Texas.
Yeah.
So that's almost 700 miles of land that was affected by one storm. And we have chapters, thankfully, we have chapters all along the coast, and we mobilized ahead of time. We were having conversations like the week before it hit about how we were going to position ourselves.
Yeah.
Well, we did our best, we did our due diligence to make sure we were in the right place at the right time.
Mm-hmm.
Unfortunately, Mother Nature tried to stymie us in a couple of places.
Wow.
So we had supplies positioned in one place, but we couldn't get to them because of the water.
Oh my gosh.
You know, like most responders,
right,
were unable to get to the places they need to go.
Right.
We had some trouble getting to the places we needed to go, but thanks to those first responders, we were able, they helped us get to the places we need to go.
Wow.
Because we don't have boats or things like that. You know, that's not part of the Red Cross mandate.
Mm-hmm.
But some of our partners do,
right,
and they very willingly and happily lent them to us. We have people donating helicopters to us because we supply a little over 15 local area hospitals with blood, and they still needed that blood during the response. Well, thanks to those, the people that donated the helicopters, mm-hmm. we were able to get it to those to in need.
In record time.
Oh yeah, so things like that. So we were, the outpouring of support from people all over the nation. We had people from every state come through to volunteer for the Red Cross. For Hurricane Harvey.
Awesome.
It was incredible, and we are so grateful. Like, we really, really are.
This is a good opportunity to say thank you.
Yes.
Just look in that camera and just say thank you.
Thank you to everyone who came to the Texas Gulf Coast to support us. The Red Cross really appreciates it, as do all of the residents of the Texas Gulf Coast. Any one of them that you come up to, you tell them that you were a volunteer, that you volunteered during Hurricane Harvey, and right. you'll probably get a hug, because that's the way we are in Texas.
Yeah, that's the way we are.
So once we finished with the initial response, mm-hmm. We moved into recovery. And part of the recovery is financial assistance.
Okay.
So we did the immediate financial assistance, where we had a little bit of a hiccup with
right.
with the online distribution.
Okay.
But we've worked the majority of that out, and I believe there are only a few cases that are still in an appeals process.
Okay, so right now no one can apply any longer.
No,
okay.
that's all closed.
Okay.
And that was really the first phase mm-hmm. of financial assistance.
Okay.
So what we ended up doing, just to make sure that all the rest of those people, just to make sure that everybody that had originally applied would be heard. To determine whether or not they actually qualified to receive the immediate assistance,
mm-hmm.
we got a team together, and they're in the back there.
Right now.
Right now, it's a team of about 40 people who are going through case by case,
mm-hmm.
and they're almost done.
Okay,
so we're really happy about that.
So they're going through only those cases for those who appealed.
Right.
Okay. Because
And not just the people who appealed, but people who had issues.
Okay.
So if you applied mm-hmm. and you had an issue,
mm-hmm.
And it somehow you got caught up in the system.
What do you mean issue? Like a denial?
No. Like there was a technical issue. Like you got the you were approved,
okay.
but you were never able to get
okay.
the money.
Okay.
So
gotcha.
Those people are working out all of those issues to make sure that those people get the money that they were approved for.
Okay.
But then we also have the other bucket, which were the people who were denied and appealed.
Okay, gotcha.
So they're working through those two different streams of people, and they're almost done.
Okay.
And then we move into the next phase of recovery, which is called long-term recovery.
Right.
So because this was such a major operation, it affected so many people,
mm-hmm.
and we received so much money from our donors,
right.
we have money left over to do a larger recovery program, and it's called a long-term recovery program.
So who can qualify for this long-term recovery program? Because it's very important to me personally, because our community doesn't really know how to go out there and look for these kinds of help. Like, in our community, a lot of people didn't even know you could even apply for the immediate financial assistance. And then we started hearing that people who were applying were not even eligible, but they were filling out the forms mm-hmm. and putting the correct information. They were getting this money, and people from my community who were being truthful on their applications were being denied. So it's like it made a lot of people feel like, well, if you tell the truth on your application, you're not going to get the assistance, and those who know what to say are the ones who are going to benefit, and those people may not even need the assistance. So that's over now, but from what you're saying, it appears that many of us from our community can even qualify for the long-term recovery program. So how do they apply?
So we're still working that out, but this won't be as broad.
Okay.
So we only had like a few questions for the immediate assistance, because the purpose of that program
mm-hmm.
was to get the most help in the most hands as soon
as possible. Yeah,
that was the whole purpose. And it was $400. We were hoping that it would help people with their immediate needs.
Yes.
So it's kind of like an offshoot of a program that we always have
right.
with our disaster action teams when
okay.
they respond to home fires.
Okay.
And we can go into that a little bit later.
Okay.
But to go back to our long-term recovery program,
mm-hmm.
so we're still working on exactly, you know, what the qualifications need to be.
Okay,
but
gotcha.
They will be based on FEMA
okay.
Standards.
Okay.
So, you know, we're going to be working heavily with FEMA to determine, you know, who qualifies for this program.
Okay.
So,
is there going to be like an announcement once that is done?
Yes.
Okay,
we
great.
Will do, we will have a big announcement.
Okay.
So it'll probably be at the beginning of the new year or maybe somewhere in the beginning of the new year.
Okay. Well, don't forget to send it over to VNR TV.
Oh, no. I will let you know for sure.
Part of it.
So, yes, you will definitely get the notice.
Thank you.
But yeah, so our commitment to the Texas Gulf Coast for the Hurricane Harvey recovery, we have put together a long-term recovery team that will deal specifically
okay.
with anything that deals with recovery. So we have team members that have been hired to coordinate with FEMA, with any of the long-term recovery committees
okay.
in each of the communities.
Okay, wonderful.
So we have people who are beginning to reach out
mm-hmm.
and make plans on how we can best get money into the hands of the people who need it.
Okay, wow, wonderful. This is so
yeah.
interesting. And viewers, this is the reason why we're having this special program, just so that you can have information exactly like what Ms. DeRosa has talked about at your fingertips. So make it a date. Don't forget, even after this Christmas special is over, tune in to Vineyard TV. We are always going to bring you the most current information about what's going on in our city. So I'm so excited. Thank you so much for having us, Ms. DeRosa.
You're quite welcome.
Before we leave, I just want you to, you did mention something while we're just talking behind the cameras,
okay.
you know. You spent 40 days in the backside of somewhere, and you mentioned, you know, how long the Red Cross has been in operations right here in the city.
Oh, yeah.
People
so,
would like to know that.
So the Red Cross has been in the Texas Gulf Coast, in Houston, in Beaumont, in Corpus Christi, in Harlingen for over 100 years. You know,
that's right.
We have been operating, providing services for the residents of the Texas Gulf Coast for that long,
mm-hmm.
and we will continue to do so.
Yes, with your help, of course.
With your help. So don't forget, sign up online. It's redcross.org,
mm-hmm.
and it's really easy to become a volunteer. We have lots of things that you're going to be interested in. If you like going out at a moment's notice to help someone who is suffering from a home fire or has been affected by a home fire, we have the job for you. You know, if you're interested in helping out with military services, military families, resiliency, we have a job for you. You know, if you're interested in working with people, you can help our volunteer services team. They would love to have you come and help out.
There you go.
You know, and I'm going to make a pitch for my activity.
Go for it.
We need communications volunteers. If you know how to write, you know, if you want to talk to us about what's going on in your community and the things that you volunteer for, if you know how to use social media, you know, we need volunteers in communications as well. So that's my pitch. Come
Thank
on
you
down.
So much. That's awesome. Thank you so much for having us, Ms. DeRosa. It was a pleasure talking to you.
You as well.
Thank you. So viewers, this is the end of our segment. Stay tuned. Don't go anywhere. There's more to come.